Are you in a position of leadership at work? Do you hold power and persuasion over the employees in which you manage? Do you consider yourself an effective leader? Well, if you can resonate with any of the past statements I just uttered, then I have a couple of questions I'd like for you to consider. Do you consider yourself a good listener? And can you effectively communicate messages in which you want others to receive? Do you feel you could use some helpful tips in this area? Well, if you answered yes, you came to the right place. Because you see, Hope Timberlake is a speaker, trainer, and coach who focuses on the communication side of leadership. She's passionate about persuasive messaging, executive presence, and elevating the voices of women in leadership. She joined me this week to tell me more about the good work she's doing to advance women in the workplace and to make us all effective leaders at work. I'm Kevin McShann. Let's have this conversation. Welcome you to the show, and I'm excited to talk to you this afternoon about the communication side of leadership. Great to be with you this afternoon, and thanks so very much for being here.
So happy to be here with you, Kevin. This is great.
Absolutely. Now, Hope, as you know, you focus on the communication side of leadership and persuasive messaging and executive leadership and elevating women. So I'm curious to start off this conversation by asking you, what's the best part of your job and what motivates you to do what you do?
I love that question. I do speak to a lot of people, and I don't know that anyone has ever asked me that question, or certainly not many. So that's a great one. I love working with people, particularly those who are newer in their careers, who are just sponges. They are absorbing new tactics, new skills, new ideas, trying them on at work. And by work, that could be anything that they're doing. It could be, you know, they might be self-employed, they might be working for a large corporation, or maybe they're not even working at all, and they're communicating in their households or with their neighbors. But I think there's something really dynamic about working with a group who can support each other, give each other feedback, really share ideas. And that's my favorite thing. Is I used to do a lot of one-on-one coaching, and now I'm really focusing on, let's leverage the power of groups and that connection that you find when you're working in a group.
Absolutely. And I'm curious to ask you about how we amplify the voices of women to give them a sense of empowerment in executive leadership roles as well.
Yeah, so my goal is to have corporate environment and leadership, and frankly, schools and government and any kind of types of systems in our world, in our country, to look different, to not just be one pale and male. We really want to have some different ideas, different experiences. So what I'm really trying to do is work with people who are ideally a little bit earlier on, so that they have the skills, they have the mindset, they have the ability to be more visible, to share their, to take risks, to be more willing to raise their hand and say, I'll do this, I'll try this, I'll speak at this opportunity, so that we can get more people moving up the ranks and ideally in the leadership positions.
And we examine persuasive messaging and presence. I'm also curious to ask you how we can apply that for individuals with disabilities, because I was born with what's called spastic quadriplegia of cerebral palsy, and a large part of my work outside of this podcast is amplifying the voices of people with disabilities to ensure that they have equal opportunities when it comes to employment. So I'm curious to get your thoughts there as well on how we provide avenues of opportunities for folks with disabilities as well.
Yeah, it's a great, important question, Kevin. And one of the things that I say, and people might take it the wrong way when I say this, is when we talk about persuasive messaging, a lot of times what I'm referring to is really thinking about who your audience is and how you can bridge where your perspective is and what their needs are. So, for example, Kevin, if you're saying, I really want to make sure that people with disabilities have every ask ac access to jobs and to moving up the corporate ladder, so that's your perspective and that's your goal, how can you communicate that in a way that it meets the company's needs? So, for example, how does the company benefit? Well, the company benefits because it has different perspectives, it has different experiences. People who come from a different background, who have different experiences, can lend different ideas. We don't have as much group think where people are all just agreeing with each other or making decisions based on the same set of experiences. So if we can tie in what your objective is with the company's needs, we're much more likely to be persuasive and to make progress.
And Hope, I'm curious to also ask you about the power of human connection. Because of the pandemic, certainly business networking has looked a lot different these days. But I'm curious to get your thoughts on how important you think touching the flesh of people, for lack of a better term, will be exciting to get back to once the pandemic has subsided.
Yeah, I don't know about you, Kevin, but I can't wait to be with people. I'm a people person, and I just found out right before you and I spoke that I have an in-person training coming up, my first one in 15 months. Small.
Yay!
Yes, I'm so excited. So it's pretty small, and we'll be socially distanced, but it's super exciting. I just think that we're so hungry for it, and I don't know the research on this, but someone was telling me about all of the nerve endings and how that really does help our state, our emotional state. And so touch is so important. And that could be from a handshake to a hug to a kiss on the cheek or whatever it is that we were doing in person where we had that physical touch with with our friends and with certain close business people. We've lacked that. We've lacked that for over a year. And I do think it definitely dampens our spirits. So I am personally very excited to be interacting with people, even if it's outdoors over coffee, whatever, bring it on.
Absolutely. I'll never discount the value of human connection again, that's for sure. And I hope I'm curious to also ask you, CBS News and NBC News have also reported that because of the pandemic, approximately 3 million women have left the workforce because of a lack of childcare and for other child rearing responsibilities. So I'm curious to get your thoughts on how we create more opportunities for women to re-enter the workforce as well.
Yeah, that breaks my heart. Yes, for the women and for their families, but also for our society. If we are not going to create a society in which that allows families to be able to take care of their family and to contribute to the work front, we're going to see really dysfunctional businesses. So 100%, I really hope that this pushes forth the conversation of having better access to childcare, of having companies that really see how they can do job share positions, or they can do different types of work hours different hybrid positions where sometimes they're working from home, sometimes they're in person. And it, whether it's hybrid of where you're working or how many hours you're working or what type of tasks you're working on. I personally would love to see a version of collaboration within companies where you can do this by generation, where you have someone who's been in the workplace for decades and someone who's brand new in the workplace. And there's so many compliments around what a digital native brings versus someone with lots of experience, or a parent who has had to navigate all the logistics and had to raise children, to discipline, to motivate, to set values, set boundaries. I mean, so many of those tasks that you do in the home front are directly related to what you do at work. And so if we can see the value in that and potentially take a parent and combine them with, you know, pair them up with somebody who is maybe at work the 40 hours that's needed, and can we leverage both of their skill sets? So I'm hopeful. I'm an eternal optimist, potentially a delusional optimist at times. I thought the pandemic would end by June 1st, 2020, but I hope that we can see a real change in how our society values parents, and particularly women, because that's who's been hurt most by this, and how companies can come up with more flexible, innovative ways of incorporating parents into their jobs.
Absolutely. And Hope, I know that congratulations is in order because you're working to publish a book in October of 2021 called Speak Up, Damn It, How to Quiet Your Fears and Polish Your Presence and Share Your Voice. So I would love for you to talk about the book, what it is about, and how excited you are for it.
I'm super excited. Thank you for bringing that up, Kevin. So one of the reasons why I wrote it was I was spending a lot of time working with leaders of industry. So I was working with a lot of people who were in the executive suite, helping them with their communication skills. And I liked everyone. I mean, I'm a people person. I've liked, I think, almost everyone I've ever worked with. But what I saw was that the budgets were at the top. There wasn't the same kind of budget for coaching at the bottom of the organization. And so the book is a two-part goal of trying to get more young professionals and different types of professionals the skills that the top of the organization gets. So it's very much exercise driven. It's each chapter has a story, and then it has a lesson, and then it has exercises that people could do on their own. They could do in pairs, they could do, you know, at work, or they could do it at home. And my goal is for people to read this book and to say, oh my gosh, I now feel like I have the confidence to do this. I know how to do it. And I'm going to go ahead and share my voice more often. And I have a story for you, Kevin. I have some advanced readers who read the book before it's come out. And one woman said, okay, I read this and realized I really want a new affinity group at my company. And she works for a very large organization. And there's probably four levels of managers between her and the CEO. And she said, I was reading the book and I decided to reach out to him and say, hey, I think it's really important that our organization have this new affinity group. And he took her call and she started this new group. And she was like, I felt the courage and I knew the tactics for doing it. And I credit it with I credit the book with giving me those skills I needed. So already with, you know, just a handful of advanced readers, I've seen some success, which makes me really excited for what can come when it comes out in October.
Well, I want to wish you the best of luck with the book. It sounds like there's some good lessons and nuggets in there. And I know that in your spare time, you also host a podcast. I don't know how you fit this all in, but when you share best practices about communication and how we communicate with each other. So tell me about the podcast, how people can listen, and anything else you would like to share.
Thank you. Well, you know, to be honest, I actually am not hosting one, but I'm a guest on many podcasts. So I have been on quite a few podcasts recently, and that's been very fun. And I put them on my either my LinkedIn or my Instagram at Hope Timberlake. And what I really love is hearing from people. If your listeners or your viewers have either a communication challenge or a communication success that they want to share, I would love to hear it. And I'm also doing some, training. So I'm doing some virtual training. I call them master classes, where we meet in small groups, no more than 20 people. And we go through, we meet for 4 weeks. It's just in person. It's only 1 hour each week, but there's homework and there's assignments in between. And it's been really, really interesting because it's been across different industries, across different roles, different geographies. We've had people from India, people from South America, a lot of people from North America. And it's been, you know, different colors, creed, sexual orientation, all the whole bit. And it's been really, really cool to watch this group work well together. They don't know each other, and they together are supporting each other, practicing communication skills, learning persuasive skills, overcoming complications. So that piece of it is on my, I have information about that on my website, which is hopetimberlake.com.
Fantastic, Hope. And I'm curious to end our conversation today by asking you, what in life are you most grateful for? You seem to be impacting a lot of people in a positive way. So I'm curious, in life, whether it be professionally or personally, what are you most grateful for?
Honestly, Kevin, I'm a lover of life. And I think I'm of course grateful for my family and my community and the support I receive from people. But I'm just grateful each and every day to wake up and, you know, live another day. Just happy to be here.
Absolutely. And what's the best way people can get connected with you? It's through your website, I would imagine.
Yeah.
And do you have any other ways of connecting with people?
Yeah, Instagram and LinkedIn, searching Hope Timberlake on Instagram, LinkedIn, or going to hopetimberlake.com. I would love to connect with any of your listeners.
Fantastic, Hope. I really enjoyed our conversation. Being a journalism graduate and major myself, I really enjoyed our conversation about communication and better leadership skills. And I want to thank you for your time, expertise, and insights. It's most appreciated. And I want to thank you for being here this afternoon.
Thank you, Kevin. It's a pleasure speaking with you.